Paltrocast.
Peter, aside from doing press where you answer the same questions over and over and over again, good day for you so far?
Yeah, great day. I mean, a few of the same questions, but I've been working on this movie for 8 years, man. So for it to finally be out, I don't know, having a baby, having a something, I don't know. I mean, I never had a baby, but I've had this movie, so it certainly feels like one. So just being able to talk about it, get it out, it feels awesome.
You actually answered two of the things that I was going to ask right there. So let's take it in a different direction. Not intended to be a spoiler of sorts, but I didn't realize until I saw this film, I had seen Mr. Jimmy live. I didn't realize he was the guitarist in the Bonham Led Zeppelin Experience that I saw last summer open for Joe Bonamassa. Is that something that you've heard a number of times from interviews and feedback from industry folks?
That they didn't know they had seen him?
That they didn't know they'd seen him, because it's not like when you see Bonham live, he goes, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jimmy.
Yes, I think, it's show business, and Jason is the headliner of his band, you know. I think Jimmy in his own activity, he's the headliner, he's the star. And even in when he was in Led Zepp again, he was front and center with Jason. It's Jason Bonham. I mean, the guy's been playing with Jimmy Page, the real Jimmy Page, for 25 years. So there are still levels to this game. But I think if you really maybe you saw that show and you didn't know the guy's name, but you might have thought that guitarist was a little bit special. I hope you thought that.
Absolutely thought of that. I looked at him and I could tell that he was Japanese. And I went, that Japanese guy looks exactly like Jimmy Page. No, can't be.
And it makes you, when you see the picture of them side by side, people online start saying, does Jimmy Page have a little Japanese in him? And it's, I don't know. There is, who knows? Anyway.
Well, not to take it into racial territory here, but a lot of the greatest lead guitarists of all time are mixed race, and that's not something that we've realized until about 10 years ago. For example, Eddie Van Halen, Jimmy Page, Kirk Hammett, etc. It was almost something that they hid about themselves until recently. Now that we have AAPI month, etc., is that an angle that has kind of embraced your film at all?
I don't know. Maybe. I mean, I think it's cool just to, having been in Japan, what was cool was, I love Japan. I went there 4 times to make the movie. But if you go onto a Japanese subway in the morning, everyone is dressed like what they call a salaryman. So everyone has a white button-down shirt and maybe a black tie, and no one talks and no one's on their phone. And it is remarkably homogenous. And then all of a sudden you've got this tall, lanky Japanese guy strutting down the street in tight denim jeans with a mane of hair. And you're like, wow, to be a rock star or have the rock star vibe in Japan takes some balls. So it just made me appreciate him all the more. So I do think Japanese rock fans are loving the fact that their guy is now getting to share a stage with Jason Bonham all over the world. Cause I do think there might still be some, I don't know if it's racism or something, but a little bit of bias maybe against a Japanese guitarist. Can he rock as hard as a British guy or as a black guy or as a this guy? And
right.
Akio certainly can. I don't know, but to me, it was more not necessarily that he's Japanese or he's this or that. It was just that he came from such a remote place. We opened the movie in Tokamachi, Japan, which is not Tokyo. He grew up way in the countryside. It's one of the snowiest places in the world. They get like 10 feet of snow on the regular, if far removed from London as you could possibly get. Yet this guy's lifetime, a 40-year journey, eventually connects him directly to Jimmy Page. So for me, it's more just about, it's as far removed from, say, London and in some sense, some part of Western culture as you can be, whether that was Tokyo or Timbuktu, so to speak.
Well, this is not your first film where your documentary subject is totally an underdog, but winds up getting great results. Did you expect Akio, Jimmy, whatever you want to call him, to get as far as he ultimately did?
I don't think anyone could have said, yes, you guy on YouTube will wind up on stage with Jason Bonham, who has toured with Jimmy Page, who has played with the reunited Led Zeppelin. I mean, then again, in the past couple of years, all of a sudden Journey found a singer from YouTube. So in the past couple, I mean, I've been working on this film 8 years. So at the start of it, no, maybe 6 years in, maybe. But I guess, I mean, my impulse from the beginning was just as a pure fan of Led Zeppelin and just, I love this guy. And I don't know really who he is or what he's, or how did he come to this point? But man, I love that he's figured out every outfit that Jimmy Page ever had. I love that he's playing the hell out of these live arrangements. I just love what this guy is doing. I want to meet him and get to know him and tell his story. And I had a feeling I knew he was the best at what he did. Did I think maybe he would find a forum that would appreciate what he was doing? I don't know. I definitely, the Jason Bonham thing was a true shock when that call came through. And when we went down to Australia to film it, our little crew, we all like literally cried because we had been filming Akio for years at that point, and he just deserved it so much.
Right. Well, kudos to you on not only a great film that you stuck with for 8 years, but not only did you have to do all that international travel, but you also had the pleasure, and I'm saying this as a music industry person, you had the pleasure of clearing recordings and compositions by Elvis, Beatles, Muddy Water, Otis Rush, etc. I'd have to imagine that was the second hardest part of this film behind the travel.
That was the first. That's what took 4 or 5 years was... you know, I started out, in some sense, I look back and I'm like, wow, how stupid was I to start a film about the music of Led Zeppelin with really no concept of any of these rights or the this or that. But it's probably the only way it would have got done. If I had a brain or a clue about or I was a lawyer, I never would have started. But man, I just, once you start working with music on that level, well, then you're going to cut in. What are you going to cut next to Led Zeppelin? It has to be fucking Howling Wolf. It has to be Muddy Waters. It has to be music of a certain level. Otherwise, the structure of the whole thing, the integrity of the thing, is going to fall apart. And then I got a hard and fast education in how challenging that is. But you know what? There was an asterisk here, which pertains to a piece by Dmitri Shostakovich. Of all the pieces of music in the film, that wound up being a complete nightmare to clear. Which is a funny thing. But at the end of the day, when I just explained, hey, it's just me, Visa, MasterCard, American Express, Discover, and whatever other credit card is going to arrive in the mail tomorrow. At the end of the day, people came on board. The challenge was they all said the same thing. Let's do, most favored nations. We'll give you a deal as long as you're not, we're all kind of on the same level. So that was like whack-a-mole times, I think there's 50 something songs in the film, and you know, one song can have many rights holders, so you're constantly like, with the Shostakovich thing, I love Shostakovich, huge fan. You're asking for five times what Led Zeppelin is getting. If I give it to you, I mean, then I'm giving it to 42 other people, and my financial is over for the rest of my life, and my kids' lives, and their kids' lives, and their kids' lives. So it was a huge challenge, but at the end of the day, even Shostakovich, we got every piece of music in there. And I love that about the movie. It's music of Led Zeppelin performed by Akio and the music that inspired them in some way. John Lee Hooker, Howlin' Wolf, Otis Rush. And I think it's great seeing it in a movie theater. You rock out the whole time. It's great stuff.
Being a big nerd when it comes to hard rock, I know that Jimmy Page had a special relationship with Japan. Like, for example, when he did Coverdale Page, that only toured Japan, and then they went, we're done. a lot of my favorite artists only toured Japan. I think George Harrison pretty much only toured Japan as a solo artist, etc. Did you know all that going into this film, that Japan was such a special music market that had exclusives that no one else got?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a legit Jimmy Page freak, so I knew about all the Coverdale Page shows. I remember when that album coming out, I love that album. I'm thinking, oh, they're gonna come to the States next, this will be great. And then, you know, they didn't. But Akio saw that tour, and I think I had enough coffee. That was his first time he got to see Jimmy Page perform live in front of him. And he went to like every show in Tokyo. I think they did Tokyo, Osaka, another Japanese city. He saw like every show and front row. And he still tells me the story of like, Peter, I could like smell the cigarette that Jimmy Page was smoking. And I like tried to like inhale the smoke from this. And I'm like, okay. Yeah, I think, again, going over there and seeing when they love something, they love it beyond.
Yeah.
So when he's able to recreate the 73 Madison Square Garden show, you know, not only is Akio committed to doing it at this level, the stage manager, the lighting guy, everyone is like, okay, we need to recreate the original pyro cues. Yes. Okay, we'll have to bring in the fire department, but it's well worth it. And you're like, okay. And they recreated not just the amplifiers on stage and the live arrangements, but the pyro cues and the mirrored backdrop and bringing in vintage hot lights. Now everybody uses these LED lights. They brought in vintage hot lights for the stage that just gave it that vintage look. And yeah, there is something special about Japan. And kind of going back to that, if Jimmy Page hadn't gone to Japan in 2012 to promote Celebration Day, mm-hmm. Akio very likely would have spent the rest of his life in Japan. And maybe the movie doesn't happen, and he certainly doesn't join Led Zeppelin again, and he probably never winds up with Jason Bonham.
I would also give credit to David Coverdale for keeping it alive. I mean, no one gives David Coverdale, in my humble opinion, the credit he deserves, not even Robert Plant. But anyway, my last question before I let you go, are we allowed to know what's coming next from you? And I ask it because with sensitivity here, there's a couple of strikes happening. Some people don't like to reveal things before Variety or Hollywood Reporter have, but are we allowed to know what you're working on?
Oh, well, I appreciate you asking and caring. And I think I can say I'm working on, I love real things. I made documentaries and I'm actually working on a script of a real story. It's completely different than this, but the only connection is that it's real and it's a tale of obsession. My father worked on a murder case in Boston in the 80s that remains unsolved to this day, involving the Boston Police Department as the perpetrators. So it's something that's a case that I've known about for 35 years and have followed for a long time. And I'm exploring that as a script. So that might be the next one.
Well, if you ever need a private investigator to pull some skip traces and lick stuff up, come back to this guy.
Yeah. Oh.
Peter, thank you for making this film. Thank you for seeing it through. It's such a breath of air on a few levels, and really looking forward to whatever's coming next from you.
I really appreciate that, man. Thank you so much. Paltrocast.